All right. Well, thank you so much for, you know, coming on my show and being willing to be interviewed. I really appreciate it.
Oh, what
it.
Show is this? Sean Hannity or?
Yeah. Yeah. So today's show is actually called the Tactical Historian. I am Paul, the self-proclaimed tactical historian, and I am sitting with Richard Dahms, the, you know, real hero from the Korean War, real Korean War veteran, who's got some very interesting stories for us today. So thank you for coming on the show. So I guess we can just start with, where did you grow up? How was your childhood? And let's go from there.
Very good. I grew up in the city of Menasha, Wisconsin. In the Third Ward, by the time I got out of school, it was called the Bloody Third. We were kind of, we didn't have a good reputation, but it was, and all the people that I know from there, there's only one still alive, and he lives in Appleton, which is a city just north of us here. The area at that time was Nina, Menasha, Appleton. It's now one huge complex of Nina, Menasha, Appleton, Kakana, Kimberly, Combined Locks, and that all runs right straight up on Highway 41 to Green Bay, where the Packers are.
Fantastic, fantastic. And while you were growing up, did you ever think about joining the military? Was that something that was a tradition in your family or anything like that?
No, it was not. I got drafted. I turned 21 on the 30th of May, 1951, and 20 days later, I had a rifle on my shoulder. They did everything right here in the area. Then they sent us to Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri, known better as the back end of the world at that time.
I bet.
It was hot and humid.
And once you got drafted and into the military, you know, how did you feel about being drafted? Were you keen on joining the military at the time? Were you trying to avoid it? Did you not know what to expect?
That's the way it was. I accepted the fact that, yes, I get drafted like everyone else. But, of course, the Korean War had started about a year or so before that. And I think the draft was still on, and so, therefore, they had plenty of personnel at that time to, you know, send overseas or wherever they used them.
And so you went to Fort Leonard Wood. What sort of training did you receive there?
When that started out, that was pretty early. The basic training was 6 weeks, and I think after that they changed it to 8 weeks. And I'm not quite sure when that happened, but it did change to 8 weeks. I then went to advanced training to Fort Bliss, Texas, right on the border of El Paso, Texas, and Mexico.
And that advanced training was for what specific military occupation?
Anti-aircraft artillery.
Oh, really? Interesting.
Yes. What you would consider today, I think they're still in, quad 50s. That was a World War II vehicle that had, I don't remember, two or four 50 caliber machine guns on it, and it was used for anti-aircraft for World War II. And so there was a lot of that left over. And, of course, that's the thing. Also, it was 40-millimeter cannons that we practiced with down there. And I think that was a 6 or 8 week course.
And how did you take to that? What did you think of that training?
I thought it was great. You know, they're trying to teach you how to handle these types of weapon. It was my first introduction to a 50-caliber machine gun. And it did pay off in the long run once I got, you know, it was very interesting. That weapon today is still highly used throughout the military.
How did you end up in the Wolfhounds?
Well, I first took a course there for something, some type of, teaching classes or leadership type thing. And that was another 6 weeks. They had asked me if I would like to do that. I guess they thought maybe I was a little better. I don't know. But I took it. And after that was done, that was sometime late in 1951. And then I got a 10-day leave. I had to report to Seattle, Washington, to embark for North Korea.
And when you were, and that's when you were assigned to the 27th?
Well, it took about a week to get over, if I remember, maybe 2 weeks to get across the Pacific Ocean. The boat we were on was called the Marine Adder. I'm not sure how many troops were on it. Maybe what, 5,000-10,000? There were a lot of us, all going to the same place. A week or 2 weeks, I'm not quite sure. Yeah, it's been a long time. Memory is not so good sometimes after all that time. But nevertheless, we got to the port of Incheon, South Korea. We embarked there. We were then sent to the different rear areas of the units that we were going to be with. Mine was, of course, we went to the 25th Infantry Division. There were a lot of us, and we went to different units. I ended up with Company A of the 27th Infantry Regiment. And at that time, they had been, I'm not sure when they guarded the prisoners down at Kogido. It was late 1951, but at that time, we were in the rear, and we went to Company A. And I ended up 4th Squad, 3rd Platoon, and my sidekick, who we got to know really well, was Fred Merritt. He was from Perth Amboy, New Jersey. He went to 3rd Platoon, 3rd Squad, he got. And at the time, we were in the rear, but I'm not quite sure how long that all took. We lived in tents. It wasn't the greatest experience at that time either, but anyway, that's how we got to where we were. There were 11 of us that went to Company A.
Right.
I don't remember the names. I only remember Fred's and another one. Out of the 11 of us that went to the company, Fred and I were the only two that walked out of there.
Wow.
The others were either wounded or killed over a period of 6-9 months, you know.
Before we get into that, one thing I wanted to ask is, from what I understand from previous conversations with you, is that this was really your first time doing any sort of world travel. You since then, you've done some traveling, but this was your first time.
Oh, yeah, sure. I had been no place, no.
So what was that experience like, you know, going across the Pacific Ocean and then coming to this real foreign land, you know, totally 180 from the United States? What was that your initial reaction, can I ask?
Well, we're going to do what we have to do. I accepted the fact that, hey, I got drafted, we got a problem here, and we're going to try to take care of it.
Right. But out of curiosity, was there anything that when you arrived there and started to learn about, you know, the Korean cultures and the culture and the Koreans there, was there anything that surprised you? Like, you were like, oh, we don't do this in America or anything like that? That was like maybe a culture.
Okay. I'll put it right straightforward to you. Incheon was, there was nothing left of it. There's one large building left. Everything was leveled off, blown to smithereens. The one large building, they spared that because they used that for headquarters. As I got off of the ship and they took us in barges into the shoreline, we got it. As we made our way back to these division rear and company rear areas, it was like I had walked 20 years behind us in terms of how things were done. And, you know, they were quite backwards. But the people were poor. and they were Oriental, and really they didn't. These people going up these big hills with pack racks on their back, loaded with stuff, they carry it up. It was very unusual. I thought I stepped back in time by at least 20 or 30 years.
And how did the South Koreans react to you? Did they were they happy?
Oh, they,
like, they, were,
they
treated
were,
well.
They were friendly. We did at one time even have we had South Koreans with our units. We were training them, to, you know, as well. Yeah, but they see a lot of kids and women, and they were then just starting to use some of their own personnel as a military to help stop the North Koreans. Of course, the Chinese were there too, and to this day, you know, I look back on some of this and I think MacArthur was right. The war started, they had taken advantage of the fact that we just about got wiped out, except the Pusan perimeter. And that's as far as they got. And then MacArthur brought in his troops and everything, and they invaded at Incheon. That cut the whole Chinese army off from any way of getting back to their own land. And a lot of prisoners were taken, thousands of them, and they had them down in Kojido. As that happened, and MacArthur landed the Marines at Incheon, and they chased them all the way back up to the Yellow River, and that's the dividing line between North and South, North Korea and China. And when that happened, here came the Chinese. There were thousands and thousands of them on the other side of the Yellow River. Well, MacArthur said, well, let's saturation bottom them, and kill them all, and we'll settle this thing with China right away, too. He got fired. Truman fired
right.
him.
Right.
Had that happened, MacArthur would have solved a lot of problems that we still have today.
And you
China
know,
wouldn't
you brought...
be what they are today if he'd have done that, you know.
Right, right.
Well,
and
take for instance, George S. Patton, World War II. He had the Germans licked, and he went and told him, he says, here, let me take the Russians out too right away. It'll take me 6 weeks, and I'll make it look like they started it. They didn't listen to him either.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. It's amazing, you know, the what-ifs of history.
Politicians have to learn to listen to their military people. Most of them know what they're talking about. But today, I'm not so sure. We have military has been infiltrated, from my perspective, with people who are not effective or efficient.
Right. I've always said that I always misunderstood how there's so much policy that is passed in general, where politicians and you know, the senators and so on and so forth, congressmen, women, they don't listen to whatever sector it is, the boots on the ground, whether it's the military, policing, you name it. They seem to come up with these fantasy theories to push policies that don't make sense on the ground. And you see it throughout history.
Oh, absolutely. You know, we know best, you know. That's how they always
right.
seem to handle it, and they don't know best.
Right. One thing you were talking about, just to bring it back a little bit, is you sort of described very well that the situation when MacArthur made his statement and his plan to face the Chinese. When you finally made your way to the front, what was the situation on the ground by the time you were sent to the front?
Okay. In the spring of 1952... we had our company. We went up, and I don't remember who we relieved. We went up to the Mungdongni Valley. That's a valley that's running north and south, just east of Heartbreak Ridge. We went up there at midnight, and it was dark, and we positioned. This is my first introduction to, well, something entirely different from what we generally describe as great. This was in a position that, looking right down the Mong Dong Ni Valley, and out the Mong Dong Ni Valley came daylight, and I was looking right straight down it, and there's guys to my right, people to my left, and right behind me is the FO, forward observer position, just a little up above. This was high ground. There are 11 tanks that are knocked out. I don't know if there are any more today, but that's what was out there. Tank retrievers, jeeps. When they took Heartbreak Ridge earlier in the 1950s, they advanced up the Mong Dong Ni Valley, and they knocked every tank out, the tank retrievers, and I'm not sure how many people they lost. That'll be a lot. They're probably still out there today. I don't know, unless the Koreans took them apart and sold the metal. I don't know. But that's what I saw the first thing. Heartbreak Ridge on my right, and just a big, long ridge to my left, and then right down the valley I could see way down, all the way to the end of the valley. And in there, of course, was a river.
And this was a position you were expected to hold?
Yes. Yeah, we were on the what they call the main line of resistance, MLR. Okay.
Right. I just wanted to clarify for my listeners who might not know a little bit about the, you know, the conflict. At what point did you actually first time come under fire?
It was the next morning. I'm not sure that they knew that they changed, that the Wolfhounds were now up there or not. Nevertheless, as I was sitting in this position here in front of this FO, all of a sudden, boom, mortar rounds were coming in. Well, we got down into the trench as far as we could, and they only shot about two or four. That was the first experience. They missed their target. They didn't hit anything. They were just trying to keep our heads down, that's all. It was a wake-up call. And one of the guys that with me had been there for quite some time, and he said, "Duck, you hit the deck." And we did. That was the first experience I ever had, and I was a little bit scared. I won't deny that this was something different. I learned at a very young age that life is a very precious thing because it can be taken from you at the blink of an eye.
Absolutely. One thing I've heard and we've seen in the movies like Porkchop Hill and things like that is about the, I guess you could call the psychological operations that the North Koreans and the Chinese used, you know, sort of blaring messages across to you and playing sorts of music. Did you experience any of that while you
Yes.
were up there?
Yep, I did. Yeah, I don't remember offhand. Yeah, I remember there were instances where they play some music or some. One of the things that I am not sure of at this position was different. The distance between us and Heartbreak Ridge might have been a half a mile. We could see it real well. Sniping was a big thing there, but absolutely, they did try to brainwash us or try to. I heard stories about that they had women come out dance nude in the front line and to try to get somebody to defect or whatever. Well, those that did get killed, they shot her. I've heard that. It's only all I know about it. But, yeah, I believe they'd do anything to get whatever they want. You can't throw caution to the wind.
At this point, you're on the MLR. When did you actually come in contact with the enemy? Did they ever, when they attacked your position?
Okay, we were up there about a week, and it was just sniping, mortar rounds, artillery, 57 millimeter coil rifles, incoming mortar and artillery rounds. But we pulled a patrol about a week later. Off to my right, it went over, and then a big finger went right out into the valley, kind of like, so we called it a finger. It was just a small ridge. Then down toward the valley, that was the 35th Infantry Regiment. And little did I know at the time that a fellow I became very fond of, and we were great friends, he was down there in that valley with the 35th at the same time I was up. We didn't know each other then. Later years we got together, we talked about it. Well, he was down there, I was up on the hill. So, strange, it's a small world. And, okay, we had a patrol. It's called an ambush patrol. 3rd platoon pulled that off. I don't know if they drew straws or what. Anyway, the lieutenant in charge of that patrol was John Arvidson. He's deceased now. We went out on this finger. I was with the machine gun squad, so we had the machine gun, and we set it up just ahead of where the lieutenant was. Third squad and 2nd squad went down to the end of that finger, and then they, on the bottom of that finger ridge, they spread out along there. Well, about midnight, the radio operator came up, and he says, look, they're all over the place down there. And, well, we were up on the ridge quite a way. It's difficult to see when it's dark at night. Although, you would be surprised, though, your senses really get very good when you're in a dire situation. You can see a mile if you have to. And it was. They were running toward the valley, down by the river, toward the front line that was out in the valley. Well, they let them get just so far, and the patrol was around that bottom of that ridge. They opened fire on them. It was a shooting match from that point on, and they really chopped them up really bad. And then they decided to pull the patrol to get them back in, and we'd use artillery and mortar to try to, it must have been quite a force. I'm not sure how many. I didn't worry about it. Whatever the case, they pulled the patrol up. They came up and they ran past John Recanaw and myself, who were manning that machine gun position. And when they all got in, then we opened up with the machine gun. But when that patrol hit close to our MLR, all hell broke loose. I cannot describe very well what, you know, I don't care how much training you have. Triage, infiltration course, anything. There's nothing that can prepare you for what you're about to experience. There were artillery and mortar rounds going. Our mortar and artillery opened up. They were landing out in that valley off there. That Chinese or North Korean patrol must have just been decimated because it was really. But in turn, the Chinese and our North Koreans, they started to anti-fire at us. Their mortars and artillery rounds were coming in on us. It was a fight so loud. Boom, 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 boom. Every time the artillery go off, the whole valley would light up. They just kept pounding, and the enemy rounds that came in were hitting all over the place. There was machine gun fire, burp guns, tracer bullets flying all over the place. Whatever the case, they finally decided they'd pull a machine gun out of there, too. We retreated. And so we picked up the ammo, the machine gun, and a tripod. We headed out of there. I was glad to see that we were getting out of there because things were getting hot and heavy. That went on for a couple hours. And I just, a 21-year-old kid, right in the middle of one hell of a firefight, within the next couple hours, everything quieted down. And whatever happened down there in that valley, I don't know. But that enemy patrol had to really been decimated the way we found them. And don't I didn't tell you I wasn't afraid, but I did. I got up and I ran like hell when they told us to get the machine gun back in. And then I tripped and fell, went down. John thought I got hit. He said, "Dick, are you dead?" I said, "Hell no." I got up and ran all the faster. We got back to our MLR, and we said, yeah, decided to talk about it. And the squad leaders that were down in a valley that pulled off that ambush, they were discussing the things they said they did. They shot that patrol up something terrible. So that was my first experience, and I was indoctrinated after that.
You're a veteran instantly after something like that.
Well, yeah, you know, but then it becomes an everyday experience, perhaps, you know, these things happening.
Mm.
After a while, you get used to seeing these things. And guess what? Not one of us got killed or wounded. There must have been, 12, 24, maybe 25 people involved in this ambush patrol. One guy got a scratch. Me.
from tripping, huh?
Yeah. I thought it was a piece of barbed wire. The medic disagreed with me. He said, I think it was a bullet. It went right through my fatigue and just barely scraped my leg. And that's what the medic thought. So that's all I know. And we let it go at that.
Well, thank God it wasn't worse.
Close call.
Close call. Someone's looking out for you. That's great. Now, something that has come up before, and I've heard this, you know, again, we talk about these names that kind of stand out in history when we talk about the Korean War, you know, Heartbreak Ridge, Pork Chop Hill, and of course, Sandbag Castle. Can you tell me a little bit, you know, about that name, Sandbag Castle, and the story behind that?
Okay, there's several stories connected to that. We got relieved up in the Mungdungi Valley. That was in the summer of 1952. I like to say July, late July, early August of that area. And they pulled us back to, we were always short of personnel. We never had enough people to, you would think, with the draft on. Guys rotating out, some get wounded, some get killed, you know, it's an everyday experience, so you really don't know. Somebody's always coming and going. Anyway, we relieved the Turkish Brigade, which was up just to the east of Heartbreak Ridge. I have pictures of all of this, and I can tell you just exactly. We went up there. I went up there as an advanced party with Joe Graff and Jimmy Lynch. They're both deceased now. I think Jimmy Lynch was originally from New Jersey, and he became friends with a gentleman by the name of Norman Theriot. Now, Norman, he just passed away here a little while back. And he was a full-blooded Cajun. I always called him the Raging Cajun. Anyway, there were three of us on this 2.5-ton truck. I had my carbine and some ammo. Jimmy Lynch had a machine gun and a can of bullets. He said, "This is one hell of a way to fight a war, with a can of bullets and a machine gun." And Joe Graff, here he was, this guy with this big red mustache, you know. So anyway, we got up there, and Turkish brigade, they were glad to see us, so friendly, you know. The only trouble is we couldn't understand each other too well. We had to get an interpreter up there with us so we know what the hell they were talking about.
Right.
That took about an hour. Some guy came that knew how to do it. We go, and the Turks, what can I say? Just like I told somebody else, at that time, after knowing and hearing things and seeing what I did see, you could bet on one thing. I was glad they were on our side.
Oh, wow.
They were friendly, good fighters, and they were disciplined. They would go out of their way to get in a firefight with the Chinese or the North Koreans. And from what I understand, the North Koreans and the Chinese pretty much left them alone because they were scared to death of them, I think. These Turks were something else, and I found it quite an experience, too, and I've got pictures of Turks also.
Oh, wow.
And, I have pictures of a few Turks. And
did you guys trade souvenirs? I know it's kind of a tradition. People trade patches and that sort of thing.
What little we had, I gave a CIB big one for a little one, and I had some pictures. I didn't have any pictures along with me. I figured, you know, but they did. They gave me pictures of two brothers and then a couple others. In fact, I'm dealing with Guy Hinton right now with the Wolfhounds on a story that's going to appear probably in one of the next issues. And I got some pictures here yet of the Turks. And, you know, when we got there, what I had ended up with was a 50 caliber machine gun. And I was put on the left flank of Sandbag Castle. Sandbag Castle was a topographical nightmare. You couldn't dig because it was pure granite on the peak. So what the Turks did was fill sandbags and make a tunnel out to the listening post, which was manned every night by 3 or 4 or 5 people. They shared that with C Company, A Company, and B Company. We all took our turns helping them out because that place was dangerous. The listening post for our side was only 35 yards away from the Chinese or North Korean listening post. And we could sit up there and make derogatory statements all night long to each other and hear each other what we were saying. That went on all the time. Yeah. They were that close. The ridge in front of me was way out on the right flank. One of the things about Sandbag Castle is close proximity to the enemy. There was always sniper, always artillery and mortar. It was a dangerous place, and you had to really watch. Don't stick your head over the trench. You'll literally get your head blown right off. So what we found was these people, these Turks, we fixed these positions all up as we were up there for a while. Early in the summer, I think it was August, I was manning that 50 on the right flank there, and Jim Cantrell, he was from Oklahoma, he was manning it with me. And all of a sudden, 3 mortar rounds came in, boom, 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 up on our left flank towards Sandbag Castle. And all we had at that time were these sound power phones that had wires to each foxhole, trench, bunker, whatever it might be. That's the only communication you had. And I picked it up. Somebody said, is everything okay up there? Yeah, everything's okay. 10 seconds later, it came over. I need all the help I can get. Right about that time, 3 more rounds came in, and then maybe a couple more. I grabbed my carbine and I headed up there. Jim said, Dick, don't go up there. I said, why not? They need help. Well, about time I got, there's a rocky stone path that you could hardly walk on to get up to that area or down from it.
Right.
I got out there, and I hear some guy running full speed. I'm hit. And he was running. When you're hit, what are you running for? So I knocked him down to the ground, and his hand was all a mess. I got Jim Cantrell. I says, put your first aid pack around that arm and take him down. Who's going to man the 50? I said, leave it be for now. But all of a sudden, here 2 more guys were coming up, medics. One of them grabbed him and took him down. So I grabbed my carbine and I headed up to help him out there. About that time, 2 war order rounds came in. One guy got hit right along that little path and he rolled downhill. The other one went down right on the path. The other guy that was coming up the hill with this other one must have been a medic, I'm not really sure. I said, you take the one on a trail, on the little trail. I said, I'll get the guy that went down the hill. So I got down there by him, and I just rolled him over. His upper torso, well, it wasn't. And nothing I could do for him. I put him back down. It took me a few seconds to shake that off. And that didn't last long because here three more order rounds came in. By the time I got, I made my way up to that trail. Here's a guy sitting on the path trying to put a first aid thing on his leg. He took a piece of shrapnel right in the leg, and I helped him out the best I could. And I'm sure. And I could see a guy over on my left, and I knew who it was. His name was John Livingston. He was just sitting there. There was no question in my mind. He never knew what hit him. But at the same time, I was helping this guy, somebody by me, Dick, give me a hand with Bob. He's hurt real bad. So I turned around to go help him. Oh, my God. His name was Bob Hill, Robert Hill. I didn't know him personally. I had seen him. His legs were a mess. So I went over there. We picked him up. We slid the litter right underneath him because he could. And we got partway down. I took the bottom side of it. Willie Pinero, who happened to be there, he's the guy that said asked me to help him. And we started down the hill. Here came two more medics that were going to help. They took Bob down the hill. And it was horrific. Whatever the case, here was a young man whom, in spite of what happened to him, when we started to get together in the early 1990s and things, and get these people to get the Wolfhound organization, in case you're wondering, I am a founder of that, you know.
That's a fantastic organization.
Yes. 45 years later, I got a hold of Willie Pinero. And we got to talking. He said, I just visited Bob Hill here. I said, what? Yeah, Bob Hill, he works here in the area. You mean he's alive? Yes, he is. By any stretch of the imagination, he should have bled to death. I couldn't believe it. It took me a while, And yeah, he had lived. And according to Willie, he became a vice president of a bank or something or other, but he did well in spite of his handicap. I have a picture of him and Willie, too.
Did you ever see him again in person? Or?
No. Bob Hill died at age 96. I'm not sure of what. He would have been 66 or thereabouts at that time. We were all heavy smokers then, so cancer might have been something, I really don't know.
Yeah.
And that was a day, it was bad for all of us, and I'll never forget it. It's etched in my mind like it happened yesterday. Whatever the case, Bob did live. I don't recall offhand how many people got killed or wounded, but it was a lot. What we couldn't figure out was how did they know to put them mortar rounds in there like they did? There was a dugout, a piece dug out the side of the hill. They were sitting in there heating up some sea rations, and that mortar round hit right in the middle of them. And I'll go back to, I tell you that Bob Livingston, or that John Livingston who was laying there, I knew he was gone. John Livingston was supposed to go offline the next day because his brother was going online somewhere else in Korea the next day. You talk about bad luck. Well, both John and his brother got to go home. His brother accompanied John's remains. And then to find out that Bob Hill had lived, So anyway, that was a bad day. And Sandbag Castle, we could never figure that out. Anyway, from what I heard, we had spotter planes up there. We were just like picture taking in those days wasn't very good. And they'd take pictures and then they'd look on the North Korean side of that. And there seemed to be a small round thing and it looked like somebody was standing in it. First thoughts were it was a forward observer post. And when they took a closer look at it from our position, they were looking right down in our backyard up there. So that he could set the mortar rounds right in your back pocket.
Wow.
Whatever the case, they decided to read that and blow it up. And they didn't. That's that read that they had with when Lieutenant Flanagan got killed. I walked, okay. In all of this going on, they took my 50 caliber machine gun and we went up on the left flank of the castle. And I could see very well. The ridge in front of me was about 50 yards away. Sandbag Castle, maybe 50 or little, I don't remember. Did you know that they use searchlights to put them on the ground up there at night so that we could see, so we didn't get overrun effectively? And searchlights are on. You can see, yeah, they used World War II searchlights. Put them in the hills a mile or two back, and they'd shine them right on the hill. That was at night. But get back to the raid. C Company drew the short straw. So they had to pull the raid off, and that's when Lieutenant Flanagan got killed. He, when I saw him go down right away, they came across there and they had a charge of TNT with a time fuse on it, on a pole. They ran up to that spot. Sure enough, it was open. They pulled the cover off, threw the dynamite down in there, and they came back over to our LMLR. Well, when that thing went off, the whole mountain shook. I'm sure that they got rid of quite a few North Koreans at that point in time because that thing made the whole hill shook. Everything must have caved in on them. That's how that raid came about. That's what that was all about. And so about, 4 or 5 weeks later, they overran us in Sandbag Castle. And that was a two-day engagement there, too. That went on. But they could only put it this way. And one of the officers says, well, one thing is for sure. All those that came here to get us out of here, they stayed here. None of them got back. Killed them all. And that was my experience there. And there's a lot of other things that went on with that particular Sandbag Castle. It was not a good place to be. They pulled us out of there after that, and we went way over to the eastern part of the Korea, somewhere in and about the area of Pork Chop Hill. And then I rotated out on Fred and I both. But anyway, I certainly won't forget the overrun. I could see that night, it was about midnight. The mortar and artillery round barrage was just one right after another. And I had the 50 caliber. In fact, we had it bunkered up. I pulled this 50 out of the tripod for fear if a round hit there, it was going to destroy it. And I cradled it in my arms and I sat down inside that little bunker and I watched out there as we were. And the mortar and artillery, just one right after another. They were just pounding us. I think there were well over 1,000 rounds landed in that area within 5 or 6 hours. It was unbelievable. Whatever the case, I poked my head up and looked out at Sandbag Castle LP, and there, and I could see the little North Koreans running across the ridge, and I put that 50 back in tripod, and I hosed them down good. Whatever the case, they ran to the other side of the ridge because they want nothing to do with that 50. They were deadly afraid of that, too.
I bet.
And we were going small arms fire from my left on that ridge in front of us, and I hosed that down, too. In any case, I burned up 5 barrels that night, and I was running out of ammunition in the morning. And it was light, but still. About 10 o'clock in the morning, an officer came by, and he said, shoot the LP and the OP out there. I said, Lieutenant, what about our people? He says, it's been overrun. We don't have it right now. Okay. So I hosed it down, and I hosed it good. Whatever the case, I had in my mind for some years, I wonder if some of our guy guards perhaps were hit by a 50 caliber slug. Well, we got together 45 years later. I did find out that no, nobody got hit with a 50, but I thought about it for many years, if that ever happened. Mm. You know, you wonder about it and you don't know. So that it was refreshing to find out that at least nobody got hit by my 50 caliber machine gun.
And this was during that engagement to pull off Sandbag Castle?
Yeah, they overran us
this
up there.
The last overran, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They blew, so, I got a picture of that, too. They blew it all to hell.
And real quick, do we know or does anyone know where that nickname came from and how it was coined?
Because it was all sandbags.
Yeah. Yeah.
They, you know, like I told you, they built it up, made tunnels out to the LP and the OP, all sandbags.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't dig, so they just built on top of it.
That's how
the whole area was like that. I got pictures of that, too. After that, we did go out on a patrol over that Pork Chop Hill area, and that ended up to be, we didn't get in any firefight because we caught them trying to sneak in on us. Fred Merritt and I caught them, and we gave them an artillery barrage. We pulled the patrol out of the air. By that time, I was a sergeant first class, so Fred and I were leading the whole third platoon.
Promotion was pretty quick, I imagine, in those circumstances. Huh? I'd say promotion was pretty quick in those circumstances.
Yeah. You do what you have to do. You adapt to the situation, and you better do it well, or you might be dead.
I think we're getting close to being about that time for, you know, the perfect segment timing of an episode. It's just a couple more questions I'd like to ask you.
Go ahead.
The one is, when you finally got the time to come home and return home, what was that experience like, finally coming home, and what was, like, the first thing you did, or what was the main thing you were dreaming about? Was it a steak dinner that you finally get to order, or what was that, you know?
Well, it was a relief to know that you weren't in any harm's way, just to know that you're, you know, it's over, I'm done with it. It's relaxing, and you thank your lucky stars you get out of there alive. And when I got home, well, let's see, late in December, I don't recall, I think it was that January before, anyway, yeah, it was so good to see my mother and dad and my dog.
Fantastic.
And that dog Fantastic. Remembered me, too.
I bet he did.
Oh, sure.
I bet
yeah,
he
it
did.
Was just completely relief, you know, that you no longer had to be under any pressure of being fired or getting shot at or killed. Or
absolutely. You know, I can imagine. And, you know, finally, the last thing I'd like to ask you before I take any more of your day is, you know, someone who went through this experience, I mean, what advice would you want to give people today, young people today, just people today in general? What would you say is some key advice you'd like to give?
Well, there's a saying out there. This is what I'm going to tell you. All that's necessary for evil to prevail are for good people to do nothing. If we do nothing, we are doomed. Therefore, if that means eliminating evil by whatever means necessary, so be it. Does that answer your question?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Somebody has to do it.
Someone has to do it. Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for being interviewed and sharing
these
stories.
And I'll see if I can get you a few pictures out, okay?
Oh, I really appreciate that. Thank you so much, and, you know, really appreciate you doing this. Please stay in touch, and maybe we can do this again.
Yeah, why not?
It's a good time. Thank
you
so much.
Okay, Paul, you have a great day.
All right, you too.
Okay,
bye for now.
Yep. Bye-bye.